Today's date is December 10th, 1996. The survivor is Tom Lantos. The interviewer, Renee Firestone. We're in San Mateo, California, United States of America. And the language of the interview is English.
It is December 10th, 1996. It is my privilege this morning interviewing Congressman Tom Lantos. My name is Renee Firestone, R-E-N-E-E-F-I-R-E-S-T-O-N-E. We are in San Mateo, California, in the United States, and we will speak English. Good morning, Congressman.
Good morning, Renee.
Thank you for inviting us into your office and permitting us to tape your testimony.
It's a pleasure.
Can we begin by telling us your name? Spell it for us.
I'm Tom Lantos, L-A-N-T-O-S. In Hungarian, it's Lantos Tamás, L-A-N-T-O-S-T-A-M-A-S. And I was born in Budapest, Hungary on February 1, 1928.
When did you come to the United States?
In August of 1947, I actually arrived on August 23, 1947. In New York, I left Hungary on the 8th of August in a second-class railroad compartment. I was fortunate enough to get a B'nai B'rith Hillel Foundation scholarship to come to the United States, to the University of Washington. At that time, I pronounced the town Seattle because nobody told me differently that it's Seattle. I had a train ticket to Cherbourg, France. I arrived at the port of Cherbourg. I found my ship, which was a converted troop ship, the SS Marine Falcon.
We will get into this in a later time. Right now, I would like to know whether you have been known under any other name.
No.
You never had any foreign papers.
No.
Were you raised in Budapest?
Yes.
Tell us a little bit about your childhood and about the city itself.
Well, I was an only child. My mother was an extremely intelligent and well-educated woman, teacher. And my father was an intellectual and a banker. I came fairly late in life, and I was a very precocious child. I read at a very early age. I learned to play bridge at a preposterously early age, and I had to sit in my parents' lap, who held the 13 cards because my hands were too small to hold them, but I directed the play. I learned to play chess early on. I traveled with my parents. We were not wealthy. We were middle class, maybe upper middle class, but I was very conscious of the political climate, the economic climate, from a very, very early age, and I was a very old young boy.
What were your parents' names?
Paul and Anna.
What is the most precious memory you have of your father?
That's difficult. He was a very, very intelligent person. Perhaps not as warm as my mother. I suspect it was learning a lot of things from him. I had a much warmer, a much closer relationship with my mother than with my father.
Have you spent time with your father?
Yes. I spent time with both, a lot of time with both, but I was very, very close to my mother's family. She had two sisters, one brother, and it was an enormously tightly knit family. And later on, as things developed, I had three cousins, all men, and my mother's younger brother were the age where they sent these young men in labor battalions to the Russian front. All four of them perished, and I do not know how or where or when. This was in the early 40s. I was not part of this process because I was too young. But obviously it had a tremendous impact on our family. As a matter of fact, my oldest cousin is a truly brilliant man called Dr. George Kreilesheim, a professor and a linguist whose specialty was Italian, married a lady literally weeks before he was sent to the Russian front as a Jew in a labor battalion. This lady still lives. I have supported her through the decades, and I see her every time I go to Hungary. A most remarkable woman who has been a widow since the early 1940s. It's now almost 1997. And while she's obviously very near the end of her life, throughout she has maintained her intellectual curiosity and interest. Every year, for years, I gave her a gift of a trip to anywhere she wanted to go to. And she had the most bizarre requests. She once wanted to go to Turkey, and I arranged for her a comprehensive bus tour of Turkey. She visited my wife and our children and me here in California several times. But it was a very unusual family situation because of all the quote-unquote children in the extended family, my uncle was not yet married when he was taken to the Russian front and perished, and my three cousins, all of whom I was very close to, and I was exceptionally close to my uncle, they all perished. So the only human being in my family of my generation who survived was me.
Let's go back for a minute. What schooling did you have in Europe?
I attended elementary school in my neighborhood called Sziget Utcai Elementary School. I spent 4 years there. Then I enrolled in a gymnasium, a high school by the name of Berzsenyi Daniel Gymnasium. I was fortunate enough to be in an exceptionally strong class. Of course, it was a non-coeducational school. All these schools at that time were non-coeducational. It still exists. It was located and is located on a street called Marko Utca. Across the street was the ambulance service of Budapest, so all day we heard the ambulances come and go. I was a very good student. But there were lots of very good students in that class. Probably the best is still my closest friend, with whom I went through school, went through forced labor camp, and he now is a very distinguished physician in Canada. We just had one of our many class reunions in Budapest in September, just 2.5 months ago. My education, of course, was interrupted.
Just one moment.
Sure.
Before we go into that, was the school a public school?
The school was a public school.
Did you have any interactions, any friendships with non-Jews?
Yes, I did. I had several good friends who were non-Jewish. One of them, by the name of Roma Ilotzi, was a Catholic boy, and we visited back and forth. We were very good friends. I had a very good friend who is still alive, and I maintain contact with him. He lives in Brussels. He was half Jewish. His name was Halas Ivan, and his father took him and me out on many excursions, and we have remained close friends. The school was attended by a very large number of Jewish boys, but it was mixed, and we had interaction. I also have very mixed memories of the teachers. The principal teacher of my class was a wonderful, wonderful gentleman called Horvat Antal. Horvat means Croatian in Hungarian, and he was he had a special designation, as people did who distinguished themselves in the First World War. The special designation was the word vitez. Vitez means courageous. So his name was Vitez Horvat Antal, courageous Anthony Horvat. And I have a marvelous, he was among others a Latin teacher. And I never forget the amount of Latin we memorized daily. We would march through the school room chanting prepositions that took the accusative and prepositions that took the ablative in Latin. And I can still do it, ante, apud, ad adversus, circum, citra, circa, cis, contra, erga, extra, infra, inter, juxta, op, penes, pone, pos, prope, propter, per secundum, ultra, trans. And you can wake me up in the middle of the night. I learned this when I was 10. In 6 weeks, I'll be 69. But we learned it well. We learned the ones that take the ablative. We learned to conjugate and decline. Quique quod, cum quam quod, cuius cuius cuius, cui cui cui, quo quaque. We learned Hungarian poetry. I can't tell you how many lines, unlimited numbers of lines, and I remember them all. And while I think, you know, in the broader scheme of things, it was an idiotic waste of one's time, in a sense, it enriched our lives. And I find it very interesting, René, that, of course, with my children and grandchildren, they are living and growing up under totally different circumstances. But growing up in a small country gives you a very different outlook on life than growing up in a very large country. I learned every tiny rivulet in Hungary and every tiny village and every aspect of that history, which, by the way, just celebrated its 1100th anniversary. I was at a fascinating concert just a few weeks ago, sitting in the presidential box with the Secretary of Defense of the United States, the American ambassador to Hungary, the Hungarian ambassador to Washington, and the Deputy Secretary of State, my friend Strobe Talbot, and our wives, celebrating the 1100th anniversary of the birth of Hungary. I can draw you the map of Hungary in excruciating detail, I must say that since some of my very happiest experiences relate to Hungary, and of course some of the most horrendous experiences of my life relate to Hungary, this dichotomy would have been conducive to the development of a schizophrenic personality, because I love the place, and I love the music, and I love the literature, I love the food, I love the wine, I love the music, the dances, the theater, but I have a passionate hatred for the fascists and the people who were such a nightmare.
As a child, did you encounter any anti-Semitism?
A lot.
In what way?
Well, I come from a very assimilated family. I had Jewish education, as an assimilated boy in Budapest would have. I was bar mitzvahed in the large synagogue, and by the way, I was there now for the official reopening of the large synagogue a few months ago in September with my friend, former Prime Minister Shamir of Israel, and my friend, an enormously decent human being, the President of Hungary, President Gönc, and my friend, the Israeli ambassador to Hungary, translated Prime Minister Shamir's speech. The Israeli ambassador is one of the Mengele twins. So you get chills and goose pimples as you think of these relationships and contacts. Yes, I had fist fights, and I had the phrase "bitter Jido," rotten Jew, was often used. I was a very feisty boy, and I fought back, and I had a lot of physical encounters. Some I won, some I lost. I was very conscious of the fact that Jews were being squeezed commercially, educationally, culturally, in every sense. As you know, the first anti-Jewish law after the First World War, restricting the number of Jews attending university, the numerus clausus, was passed in Hungary, not in Germany. I was a very political boy from early on. My parents were very political. My uncle was very political. So I read the newspapers, and I knew all these fascist, semi-fascist, anti-Semitic, right-wing political leaders. They were part of my upbringing. I can sing you some bawdy songs about these various fascist bastards whom my parents taught me to hate. I remember the first newspaper I bought, was coming back from school the day Hitler marched into Austria, the day of the Anschluss. And the newspapers in banner headlines said, "Hitler marches into Austria." And I was coming back from school, and I was 10 years old. But I sensed that this is a historic day. So for the first time in my life, I took out my little pouch and took the few pennies that I had and bought that newspaper and took it home, because I knew I was bringing home an important piece of news.
In what way did your family observe the Jewish religion?
Well, we were not kosher. We observed the high holidays. I was bar mitzvahed. We celebrated Hanukkah. We fasted on Yom Kippur. But I felt very Jewish in a cultural and political sense. Jews come in many sizes and shapes, there was a lot of discussion about converting and so on and so forth, and I never entertained that for a moment. I mean, I was very proud to be a Jew.
How about leaving?
You mean why the family did not leave?
Did they think about it?
Well, you know, in retrospect, not leaving appears like an idiotic decision. And since in 38, 39, I was 10, 11 years old, I have difficulty putting myself in the boots of my elders. But I believe that the main reason was that the enormity of the Holocaust that was to follow could not be conceived. I mean, we listen to the BBC and we listen to Western broadcasts, and we understood that a war is coming and so on. But the expectation was that we would survive the war, that Hungary under Admiral Horthy was an ally of Germany, and it will be difficult for the Jews. But it never crossed anyone's mind in our family. Obviously, it was a fatal flaw. The Jews would be exterminated. I mean, we knew the history of the persecution of the Jews through the centuries. But even in Spain in 1492, it was an expulsion and not a Holocaust.
When you bought the newspaper, what did you read? What did you understand?
Well, I not only understood the basic facts that Germany took over Austria, but I also understood that many of the Austrians loved it, and the German troops were received, and subsequently, of course, I have seen motion pictures of this with tremendous adulation and excitement and joy. The Austrians, with great skill over the years, have attempted to paint Austria as the first victim of Hitler, when in point of fact, to an overwhelming extent, they were the first co-conspirator with Hitler. I don't think I was sophisticated enough to analyze it, but perhaps subliminally I felt that while Austria had been a separate country, it was nevertheless a German-speaking country, and there was some difference between Nazi Germany taking over another German country, German-speaking country, and Hungary, which was very different linguistically, historically, culturally. I'm reluctant to analyze, because I think I'm analyzing from the retrospective knowledge of my having lived through these last 68, 69 years, rather than the way I looked at it as a boy of 10.
When did you first hear the name Hitler, and what did it mean to you? How did you understand?
My family talked about it in the early 30s, and I spoke German, As a matter of fact, I first learned German before I learned Hungarian, and I no longer am, but I was practically bilingual in the 30s.
How did you speak to your parents?
I spoke Hungarian to my parents, but both of my parents were absolutely fluent in German. My mother also was fluent in French and English. And I heard Hitler on the radio. I can't give you the year, but I was a little boy. Whether I was 5 or 7, I couldn't tell you. But it was at about that stage.
How old were you when you began to comprehend what the word Hitler meant?
That's a very difficult one to answer, because you see, even after the Anschluss, the taking of Austria, I did not fully understand what the word Hitler and Nazism meant. I understood the hatred for the Jews. I understood the persecution of the Jews. I understood Kristallnacht. I understood lots of things, but I really was part of and born into a highly civilized Western European family and culture. And gas chambers were not part of my scheme or of my framework. So I knew, for instance, that there was such an organization as Hitlerjugend. An aunt and uncle of mine had a villa up in Buda, and a very large place very near it was taken over for the summer by Hitlerjugend in the early 40s, I don't remember what year. And I saw these German young boys playing and exercising and being there, but I really did not, even at that time, could go down the road all the way to what the Holocaust would mean. I knew it was a horrible, vicious, anti-Semitic, anti-democratic, rotten crowd, but I did not dream that it could go this far.
But did you realize that you were excluded?
Yes, of course, I very much realized it.
How did it feel?
Well, I resented it, but I was always very self-confident, and I did not feel inferior. I felt excluded. I felt discriminated against, but I never for a moment did I feel inferior.
Did you fear? Were you afraid?
Well, there were situations which were frightening, Jews being beaten up, and of course, to me personally, the most direct impact was the shipping of my uncle and cousins in labor battalions to the Soviet front, whereas all Jews, they were not allowed to bear arms, but they did the dirty work of the Hungarian Second Army, digging trenches and clearing minefields and working like pack horses.
We will stop for a moment to change tapes, and we're going to this.
Very good.
We were talking about the beginning of your recognition of anti-Semitism, Hitlerism, Nazism, and how did it affect you, and what did you think personally is going to happen to you?
Well, I knew that a war was coming, and I remember we were coming back from an outing in Buda to our apartment in Pest, and we were walking, and the window was open in the house, and the radio announced that the Second World War had begun. Although I was only 11, I had been a student is too strong a word. As a boy, I read a great deal about the First World War. The First World War was a very traumatic event for Hungary because Hungary lost huge portions of its territory and its population. And I had several friends whose fathers were in the war, and I read a great deal about the war, heard a great deal about the war, and I knew that it is horrible, and with the new weapons it will be more horrible. I followed as a boy the Spanish Civil War, so I knew about the new power of the military airplane and what havoc it can create and the increase in firepower and all that. But I did not have a feeling of personal fear. I mean, I didn't at that time view myself as being in particular danger. I realized that Hungary will be an ally of Hitler and Mussolini. As a matter of fact, you know, that's a rather interesting point, because one of the great joys for me of being in the United States, and I am patriotic beyond anything you can imagine, is that when I came to this country in 1947, and then subsequently I became a citizen, for the first time in my life I was on the side where I wanted to be. Because those early years, I mean, particularly during the war, I was, of course, hoping and praying and rooting and working to have the other side win. And this became particularly poignant when I was in a forced labor camp north of Budapest, where the British and American air forces were bombing us all the time. And I have very mixed feelings, because I wanted the bombing raids to be very successful and have the railroad bridge destroyed on which I was working. But still, you were hoping that you might survive. I really was too busy with my day-to-day life to, you know, have long-term fears or concerns. I knew that the times will be difficult, and they will be particularly difficult for Jews.
Were you aware of the fact before the war even started that Germany claimed part of Czechoslovakia?
Yes, I was.
Now, it affected Hungary in
yes,
a different
it did.
Way. What did you think?
Oh, I had personal experiences with that, and let me tell you what they are. It's one of my most vivid memories. In what used to be northeast Hungary, there is a fairly major town. The Czechoslovak name for it is Košice, the Hungarian name is Kosha. My young uncle was a high school teacher, and his high school was one of the high schools that went up to Košice when the Hungarians took it over, and I went with them. So I was part of this unbelievable, you know, German-Hungarian fascist invasion of democratic Czechoslovakia. I was an unwitting, unwilling participant waving the Hungarian flag. I remember when Mussolini's son-in-law, Count Ciano, the Italian foreign minister, came to Budapest, and my school was one of the schools that lined the main street, Andrássy út, which is a beautiful boulevard, and I had a Hungarian flag in one hand and an Italian flag in the other hand, and I was chanting Ciano, 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 Ciano. So I was more than aware. I was a participant, as all of us kids were.
When Hitler began the war in Poland, did it affect you or your family in any way?
Not personally. We were aware. We followed events. The BBC was sort of our daily avenue to truth. And I listened to it. I can still see this large radio set we had, and it had a sort of a colored seeing eye, and when it was closed, then you got perfect reception. It was very difficult, as we had to juggle the tuning, and I became very good at it, and we always, depending on how far along the war and the German and the Nazi suppression was, we closed the curtains and lowered the shades and sort of huddled around this set and listened. So the answer is yes. We followed things and we followed them on maps, and we were hoping and praying for the British and the French and then the Russians and then the Americans to be victorious. Much later, I must tell you, as a member of Congress, when I took congressional delegations to the Soviet Union, I always got a very stunned and startled reaction from my Soviet hosts when I said that I'm the only member of Congress who owes his life to the Soviet Army. And to make it even more specific, both my friend Sharansky, who is now Minister of Trade and Industry in Israel, and I believe that his father was part of the military unit that liberated me in Budapest in January 45.
Interesting.
Yeah, we had a long talk, Sharansky and I, about his father and his father's whereabouts during this period. And we believe he was part of the unit that liberated me.
Did you hear on the radio Hitler's speeches?
Yes.
Did you discuss it with your family?
Yes.
What were the discussions?
I have to be very careful not to give my current interpretation of what I thought at the time. As I recall, we became increasingly more and more aware of the nightmare quality of this man, his hatred, his venom, his viciousness. But through some mysterious disconnect, which to this moment I cannot explain or understand, it seemed implausible to my highly civilized, cultured, democratically inclined, humanitarian family as to what the final outcome could be. It did not seem plausible. And I have a great deal of difficulty giving you a rational or logical explanation. Because the people I was listening to, and I obviously was just a boy, so I didn't participate. I listened more than I spoke, obviously. These were very intelligent people. but obviously blind.
Did you know any refugees, escapees from Germany or from Poland?
Not personally. No, I don't recall any personally, no.
When did the war first really had an impact on you?
Well, it really came in three segments. The first one was the calling up of my uncle and cousins for compulsory labor service on the Russian front. And all of our attention, of course, was devoted to them, how to get a package to them, can we get mail from them, and so on. And this was highly personal because this was a very tight-knit family. And the four young men in the family, my uncle and the three boys, who were anywhere from 6 to 15 years older than I was. That's why I wasn't part of this group. Our whole life focused on them. I mean, that was very personal. And it became increasingly more and more bleak as to whether they will ever come back. But of course, while we were hoping, long after the war, that somebody will turn up, nobody ever did. So that was the first personal impact.
Was this explained by the government? Why did they take these boys?
Well, the government was very self-righteous about it. I mean, Hungary was an ally of Germany. The Hungarian troops fought alongside the German troops. Jews were not trustworthy to fight. They could not bear arms, but they had to carry the burden of doing the dirty work for the Hungarian army. I mean, there's no secret about it. I remember songs that Hungarian soldiers coming back from the Russian front were singing. And I remember one song in particular which said that I will be a barber, Borbély Legény leszek, and his job will be to slit every Jew's throat. I'll never forget that song. I heard it many times. The second personal impact came on March 19, 1944, when Hitler's troops occupied Hungary. And of course, this represented the change in the fate of Hungarian Jews. And I won't repeat the historic facts because we all know them. The countryside Jews were all herded into railroad cars and shipped to Auschwitz, other places. And that's when Wallenberg came and helped make the city, Jewish population, Budapest, survive. That is when I was put into a forced labor camp, so that became very personal.
How were you called into the labor camp? What announcement? What?
I recall having a document distributed in the house where we were living that all Jews between certain ages, and I fell into that category, had to report. And it was a quasi-military operation, and I was inducted into a forced labor battalion. I was taken up north of Budapest. The Danube makes a 90-degree turn. We call it the Danube Bend. There are important railroad bridges there and so on. And I was there working on the railroad, repairing the damage.
Were you still in school when this happened?
Well, I was in the sixth of the eight grades of the high school, but obviously that all came to a screeching halt. I mean, I was pushed into this forced labor camp along with everybody else. So that was the second phase. And while quite a few of my colleagues were killed as a result of aerial bombardment. I also worked on a heavy industrial island near Budapest called Csepel. I worked there as a forced labor battalion person. Between March 19, 1944, and October 15, 1994, Hungary basically still had a non-bloodthirsty leader in the person of Admiral Horthy, who was anti-Semitic, but not in a bloodthirsty fashion. On October 15, 1944, when the Germans got wind that he is attempting to make a separate peace with the Allies, they arrested him, they arrested his son, they organized a coup, and the most vicious Hungarian fascist, the head of the Aerocross Party, Szálasi, took over. And at that point, Jews became even more endangered. So my own personal involvement, and I don't attach much importance to what happened to me personally. Quite frankly, I didn't expect to survive after a while. I mean, many of the things that I did, while they were useful to people, they were not courageous, because I was convinced as 1944 dragged on that my chances of survival were nil.
So let's go back to the first time when you entered the labor force.
Yes.
Where did they take you? What did they tell you? How did they treat you?
Well, they took us to a small town north of Budapest called Szob, S-Z-O-B. We were put into work battalions, and we had to work the railroad. The railroad was being bombed, and we had to repair. We lived in under very primitive circumstances. We got very little and low quality food. Occasionally we were beaten. We were treated viciously.
By whom?
By the Hungarian Aerocross guards who ran this labor battalion camp. But even that period did not give me an inkling that there is a gas chamber at the end of this line. I mean, this was still profoundly different from what I, in retrospect, now view as mass extermination. I mean, my friend Elie Wiesel had a very different set of experiences from me. Mine was not hell, it was purgatory.
Did you have contact with your parents during this period?
I had sporadic and minimal contact. They sent me occasionally a note bribing people to get it to me. I escaped once, was caught, was beaten to a pulp.
How did you escape?
At night. You know, this is not a long distance. This town may be 30 kilometers north of Budapest, so it's walking distance. I was caught, I was put back, and my friend and I were beaten together. It was a... He, as a physician, now says he doesn't understand how we survived it. It was such a brutal beating.
When you decided to escape,
yes,
did you consider the consequences?
Well, I considered the consequences, but I also saw that there was no hope for me staying there. It was clear for me. I became convinced as the spring of 1944 unfolded, that I will not live through the year. I don't know whether the word fatalism fully expresses the feeling I had. But I sort of looked at myself almost from the outside. One of my favorite British authors is Chaucer. And one of the things I like about Chaucer is that he looks at life as if he would be sitting on a fence watching this parade go by, and he himself is part of this parade, but at the same time, he's watching the parade. And I had a very similar feeling. I mean, I knew I was part of this labor battalion, and we were as low as dirt, and if one of us died, or one of us was killed, or one of us was beaten, nobody paid any attention. And I knew that will be my fate. At the same time, I was watching this whole thing. And I suspect that helped me. And it has helped me since. I mean, what the Holocaust has done, it seems to me, to various people, is very different things. I mean, some people have been crushed by the Holocaust. I mean, survivors been crushed by the Holocaust, either physically or mentally, or psychologically, or all three. Some, and I am certainly not one of them, have turned to religion. If anything, I've turned away from religion because I cannot reconcile faith and the Holocaust. Some of us, and I put myself into this category, and I don't know whether this is 1%, 10%, I don't think it's much higher than that, have been made enormously resilient by this experience, which, speaking for myself, I still don't fully understand, although I read 100 books about it. I cannot make sense of it. But what I do is, and this is, of course, why, thanks to my wife, much of my work has focused on human rights. I mean, my wife, and because of my wife, my office has become the voice of human rights in the Congress of the United States. Human rights for Tibetans and persecuted people all over. I view this as a moral obligation. I realize that I'm making a very marginal difference, a very tiny difference. But I can't live with myself if I don't make the maximum difference I've been privileged to be able to do as a member of Congress. So I am very grateful that I survived, much less in a personal sense, but because I am sort of part of the forces of good in this world. You know, many Holocaust survivors, I mean, a person like Elie Wiesel is the chronicler of the Holocaust. He's the conscience of the Holocaust. And I have enormous admiration for Elie and for what he has done. There's enormous talents. Some have been financially successful and have been philanthropists for good causes. And I have great respect for them. I have no money. My work is in the Congress, and through my work in the Congress, it really focuses on human rights. So what the Holocaust has done to me, it made me a human rights activist.
So let's go back again. You were captured and brought back to the labor camp.
And it took me some time to physically recover. And then I was sent back to work. And shortly thereafter, I successfully escaped, made my way to a Wallenberg protected house, number 25, St. Stephen Park, very near the bank of the Danube. where my aunt and uncle had an apartment. But of course, by this time, it was not their apartment. 25 people, 30 people lived in a place that was for two people or three people. And I became part of this group.
Did you know about Wallenberg? Did you know when Wallenberg came to Budapest?
I did not. It's very difficult for me to distinguish between what I know now and what I knew then. So I want to be very cautious. The first thing I want to say is that although I worked with Wallenberg and I was one of the young men who helped his operation, I was a young kid, one of hundreds, so I was in no sense a collaborator of his. I was a tiny, tiny cog in a vast apparatus. And my principal virtue, I think, was twofold. One, that I looked very Aryan. I looked like a Hitler Jugend. I was blue-eyed, blonde, tall, with very Nordic features. So I could be used as a messenger. I was sent out to collect. My most intense memories relate to collecting medications for people, various medications. The one person I remember most was a middle-aged man who had regular asthma attacks. I'd never seen an asthma attack before this gentleman came into my life, or I came into his life. And he had to lie down on the floor and was gasping for air. And I was the persons who sort of organized this house, they gave me the task of getting medications for all the people who needed medications. And the reason I could do that was because I had a sort of a, not a military uniform, a sort of a, not a Boy Scout uniform, they called it a Levente uniform. Levente was a Hungarian historic term. It's sort of a cadet, a military cadet uniform with a Hungarian motifs and a very handsome cap. And I moved around the city. And nobody bothered me, although I knew full well, because only Jews were circumcised, that if there was any suspicion and I had to drop my pants, that would be the end. They never asked me. And I think that's why I survived, because I moved around the city throughout the worst period, both the Horthy period and the Szálasi period, to the very, very bitter end. I did so, in retrospect, I'm convinced, not because of superior courage, but because of my conviction that I will not survive, and I might as well be of some help, of some use.
What other functions did you have?
I don't want to exaggerate the importance of the things I did. I was carrying messages to Buddha, to Pest, to various people. I was basically collecting medicine, collecting food. Taking messages to various people was a very important function. I did not engage in any military activity, but I suspect it's probably fair to say I was part of the anti-Nazi underground as a 16-year-old boy, weakening their efforts and strengthening the resistance.
We will stop again for a moment. Congressman, we were speaking about how you got into one of Wallenberg's homes. Tell me, how did you meet him? How did you, when did you meet him, and how?
Well, I didn't have a personal meeting with him as such. He came to visit the houses, and I was part of a group that greeted him. I found him enormously inspirational. I really felt he was larger than life. I think I sensed what he was doing more than I understood what he was doing. I mean, he really left behind the comfort and luxury and safety of Sweden and came to the hell that Budapest was in the summer of 1944, because he felt a common bond with human beings who were of a different ethnicity, different religion, different background, different situation from him, but he felt a personal obligation to help. And quite frankly, he has been the dominant theme of my life. He has been the dominant influence on my life, more than anybody else, more than my parents, more than any friends, more than any teachers. If I am asked at the end of my life, who is the person who shaped you and your values and your actions and your views and your energies, it's Wallenberg. I have his photo and his large facsimile of the stamp we will soon see in every post office. I have a large sign saying Wallenberg Way that Washington gave me as a remembrance of the fact that the Holocaust Museum is on Wallenberg Place. And of course, Wallenberg tied the lives of my wife and my own life together, because she has devoted years of her life to Wallenberg. She succeeded in making him a household word, and she failed in freeing him, liberating him, because we are both convinced he was alive when my wife started the work. And I am immensely grateful that I could introduce legislation, which was my first piece of legislation, making him an honorary citizen. We now have a statue in the Capitol that my wife arranged, and I passed the legislation. We have the postage stamp coming up. He will be, for generations, an inspiration of what the code of conduct of human beings needs to be, that we are our brothers and sisters' keepers.
How do you as a child remember him? What kind of a
man
was he?
I wasn't a child. I was 16. I was a very mature, very old 16. And we were very conscious of the fact that we were living in this house because through Wallenberg, this house was under, theoretically, the protection of the Royal Swedish government. We were aware of the fact that there were scores of such houses, thousands and thousands of people who were not deported to Auschwitz because of this man and what this man did. And for a young boy, 16-year-old boy, who had given up all hope of surviving the war as the year 1944 moved on, the opportunity of helping in a tiny, modest way, this incredible work that he was doing, was it gave meaning to what I thought was the last year of my life.
Do you remember him as a friendly person or serious person?
I remember him as a very serious person. I remember him as a person with a tremendous amount of personal presence, with an authority. I remember him as someone I would have followed in any direction, because I sensed that he was motivated by the finest of instincts.
How old was he?
But he was in his 30s. I don't want to give the impression for a moment that I was a collaborator of his or a friend of his. I mean, I was a totally unimportant young person who looked up to him and who admired him and who was thrilled to be able to assist in you know, the most menial ways.
We heard that he often went to the railroad station.
Yes.
Have you ever gone with him?
No, I didn't.
Also,
I saw him at the railroad station on one occasion. And it's very difficult for me now to separate the pictures I have seen since and what I remember from 1944. I mean, it's more than a half a century ago. I can only say that he dominated my thinking and my actions during those months of the latter half of 1944, the first few weeks of 45. The Russians liberated Pest first, Buda about a month later, in mid-January. And he was arrested, which I didn't know at the time, on January 17. So I really was conscious of his work for about a half a year.
Did you ever hear from him or around him that he met with Eichmann?
No. I was not at the level where, you know, I would know any of these things.
Would you have known who Eichmann was?
Yes, I believe I knew who Eichmann was. I believe I knew the name Eichmann, but I wouldn't swear to it. It's so difficult, you know, after all these decades and after all the reading I have done, to sort of try to project back to the year 1944 and remember what my frame of mind was or what my scope of knowledge was. It was very limited. It was very limited. I was like everybody else around me. I was living from day to day. I mean, there were no long-term plans. I didn't know when dawn broke that I will end that day still alive.
Did you know when he was arrested?
No, I did not know.
While you were in his house, what were they called?
Protected houses, Swedish protected houses.
When you were in one of these houses, did you have any contact with your parents?
No, they were gone.
Where were they gone?
I don't know, they were gone.
What do you know
about
them?
The only person I know, the two people I knew and I lived the last few months of the war period with them were my mother's my mother's family had four children. Her parents had four children. The oldest child was a tremendously impressive woman. Her name was Wilma, and our younger daughter reminds me of her very much. Beautiful, statuesque, decisive, strong. She perished. The number two daughter, Margaret, survived the war in this apartment with me. Her husband, Alexander, survived the war in this apartment with me. The third sister was my mother, who perished, I don't know how and when. And the fourth one was her younger brother, who perished on the Russian front. The only two people from the family that I had contact with And it was more than contact with, because after my aunt's husband died, I arranged for her to go to Vienna. And I flew to Vienna and brought her back with me. I held her hand in the plane all the way from Vienna to New York. And she had blind faith in me. She was a musician and a teacher of music and a lovely woman. And I loved all of them very much. It was very, very, I really had three mothers, but my mother and her two sisters, and there was really no difference. We were so close. She came with me to San Francisco, and she lived here with us in San Francisco. And in retrospect, I'm not sure I did the right thing, because while we gave her as loving an environment as was humanly possible, she was at an age where perhaps she should have stayed with her friends and in a place with the familiar language and customs and food and whatnot. I was in Los Angeles on university business when I heard that that she had a heart attack and passed away here in San Francisco.
Those three boys who died in labor camp were yes. her children?
Two of them were her children, and one of them was the child of the other sister.
When did you find out that your parents are gone?
There's no date, really. There is no date. There was a gradual awareness that, there was no sign of any kind. I must admit that I was not surprised. I was not surprised. I threw myself into reading about this period as soon as the war was over and articles and books were beginning to appear. And that process hasn't stopped. I don't think I understand it any better now than I did in 1945 of what happened, because there is no rational way of explaining it. I'm a very rational person. While the enormity of the literature add to our understanding of the details and the nuances, if you read 50 Holocaust memoirs, you could have read 500 Holocaust memoirs, and as this project, it fills in bits of the mosaic, but it really doesn't explain anything.
Did you know any of your grandparents?
No. One of my grandparents may have been alive when I was born, but the answer is no, I never knew them.
When did the war end for you?
Well, the war ended for me in January of 1945. As I have done since, I had many simultaneous jobs. One of my jobs was to have a pull cart. I was the horse that pulled this little cart, and I got a job from a Jewish relief agency, picking up sacks of flour at the railroad station and taking them to the bakery. So I played the role of the horse in this undertaking for a long, long period of time. Ironically, while I was working as a horse, I simultaneously became a professor of English to the Soviet general who was the commanding general of the troops that liberated Budapest, because he wanted to learn English. And somehow he found out that I was quite fluent in English. So I had a rather interesting experience. I did my horse job in the morning, and I looked like a snowman because the flour was all over my horrible clothing. I mean, I can't say clothes because I had rags. And then I had a very good friend who was smaller than I, but he had a decent suit, and I sort of barely fit into this suit. And I put on a shirt and a necktie and this horribly ill-fitting suit, and the Soviet commanding general's automobile came for me, and I sat in the automobile as the professor, very young professor. I was 17 by then, and I was taken to Soviet military headquarters, and I gave an English lesson to the general. I also had a third job, which I enjoyed very much. It almost had a follow-up. In this apartment, which used to belong to my aunt and uncle, but was a community property, there was a very attractive young couple. Their name was Budai. And the man had been a medical student. And he decided that he will set up a medical shop. I can't really say a doctor's office because he was not a doctor. And he had hidden some white medical jackets, and he had some stethoscopes. And I remember we made a sign that we put on the door which said Vrach. Vrach means physician. And he became a sort of a physician to the Russian troops. And I was his assistant. So I had a variety of costumes during the day. I had my professorial costume, my horse costume, and then I had my medical costume. And I loved having the stethoscope hang around my neck. I didn't know what to do with it. But I was assisting him with his medical attentions. I hope we didn't hurt too many people. We conceivably might have helped some. I'm not sure of that.
Was he Jewish?
Yes. Yes, he was.
Can you describe...
His name was Budai Lotzi.
Can you describe the day when you were liberated?
Yes. The artillery shelling became more and more intense over the course of the years. The Soviet troops were moving closer and closer, and it was obvious that it was only a matter of days before we would be liberated. And one very early morning, it was still pitch dark, 3 o'clock, 4 o'clock, we heard a great commotion, and suddenly Russian soldiers burst into the apartment house. And I don't know how, to this day I don't know how, they knew that these were Jews. I don't know if they knew about Wallenberg or not, but they knew that these were Jews who were hiding there, living there, waiting for the Soviet troops to come in. And they made it very clear that they will not harm us. And they, in fact, did not. Subsequently, and they gave us, I remember one of the things we got was a large sack of potatoes from them. One of the things that became a sort of very interesting aspect of my life as 1945 winter gave way to spring, everybody was poor, and the criminal elements could not take your jewelry or valuables because you had no jewelry and you had no valuables, but they took your clothes. And people sort of walked in the middle of the street. There was no streetcar or any other transportation. And the newspapers were full of these hilarious cartoons of the husband going home to his wife naked. And she is outraged, and he explains that he just ran into somebody who took his clothes. They never took my clothes. But I remember on two occasions some very large, muscular, hefty Russian military women expressed some interest in me. And I ran like a jackrabbit. And I ran faster than they did. So I retained my dignity. But these were very lively times and very turbulent times. After a few months, school reopened, and I went back and finished my high school education. Then I applied, ironically, first to the Medical University of Budapest. I was accepted, and I attended medical school very briefly, then when we were shown cadavers and skeletons, I decided that this is not for me, and I switched over to the Economics University. And at that point came probably the turning point of my life. I saw a sign saying that the B'nai B'rith Hillel Foundation is offering some scholarships to students who can speak English and who are interested in going to an American university. And I applied, never dreaming that I would have a chance, but I did.
Did you go back to your home?
Well, I lived my own home, which was really an apartment, was totally destroyed by aerial bombing during the war. It was a six-story building near the elementary school where I lived, called Island Street, Sziget Utca in Hungarian. And I remember the day we were in the bomb shelter. This was before 1944, when Budapest was heavily bombed, and there was a direct hit on the apartment house. We were in the basement. As a matter of fact, we had to break through various basement doors to other apartments, and we came out several houses away. So my home, as such, no longer existed.
Did you know that your parents weren't there then?
Yes, I did.
What did you think when you re-entered the free world, when you became free and realized that your parents are gone? Were you waiting for them? Were you hoping they'll come back? How did you imagine your life?
You know, this sounds very strange for a 17-year-old boy, but I was always enormously self-reliant. I was always a take-charge person. I never for a moment asked, what will happen to me? Who will take care of me? I felt I had a responsibility to take care of my aunt and uncle and other older people I knew. And when I came to this country, although I never had any money, when I came to this country in August of 47, within about 3 months, I had seven different part-time jobs. And I tell you, as best I can remember, what they were, and then I tell you what I did with my money, because it's sort of interesting. I worked in a grocery store at night, filling up the shelves. I worked in a furniture store, helping to carry furniture. Then later on, I also did some bookkeeping for the furniture store. I tutored Latin, math, English, French, and Italian. I had a job in a borrowed tuxedo ushering at the Seattle Symphony. And when Toscanini was at the symphony, I was one of the, maybe the only person who spoke Italian, and I had the pleasure of having dinner with him because I spoke Italian. I'll never forget it. He was in his 80s, I believe. I was the sandwich man on Sorority Row. I had a big tray in my neck with Washington State delicious apples, pies, milk, and various sandwiches. And it was a wonderful job. I would go into these sororities filled with beautiful young women, and I screamed at the top of my voice, "Sandwich man, sandwich man," and they would all come down, and I got more dates than I could handle. And I made a fortune selling all this stuff. When I got my first little money, I have no idea what it was, $20, $30, I had a wonderful friend who is still my closest friend, a Jew from Alaska by the name of Barney Gottstein. And he's my dearest and closest friend, and has been since August of 47, almost 50 years now. And he really taught me to be an American in every way, politically, how to drive a car, you name it. When I got this first batch of fortune, he said, "Well, you have a lot of money now, what do you want to do?" And I said, "I want to go to a grocery store." He said, "Fine." And we drove to a, I believe, a Safeway store, and I bought, I can see it as clearly as I can see you, I bought a pound of cocoa, a pound of chocolate, a pound of tea, and a pound of coffee, and I paid for it, and we left. He says, "Where do you want to go now?" And I said, "I want to go to another grocery store." And he's a very patient man. He still is very patient with me, and he looked at me as if I would be somewhat insane, but he took me to another grocery store a few blocks away. I bought exactly the same thing. And we came out, and he says, "Where do we go now?" And I said, "I want to go to a grocery store." And he said, "Now listen, I'm a patient guy, but I've had enough. Why don't you buy all the damn coffee and cocoa and everything else you want to buy one place?" And I said, "I don't want people to think I am hoarding scarce goods." And then he said, "Well, I'm not going to take you to a grocery store, but I'm going to buy you a cup of coffee." And I explained to you about this country and buying scarce goods. And he took me to a little coffee shop at the University District in Seattle. And he explained to me that this is a free country. Nobody cares whether I buy 1 pound of coffee or 2 pounds of coffee. And nobody will spy on me and report me to the authorities that I'm hoarding coffee. Of course, I bought all this to make packages with this, to send it home to the people that I was supporting. And this has now diminished to literally two people. Everybody else died. But in my own very modest way, I started out helping a little over a dozen people. And, you know, I was helping them in terms of my resources. Initially, I was sending $10 maybe, and occasionally, and as time went on and I got a regular job and so on, I was sending what to me were large sums, $100, $200. But I'm telling you all this because your question was I worried about my future? And I was never worried about my future.
We have to stop for a minute. I want to hear the rest of the story. back for a minute to Hungary. You applied for the scholarship.
Yes.
How did it come about?
Well, it came about really in two stages. One stage I saw, the other stage I didn't. And then there is a sort of a footnote to it all. I was called in to the U.S. legation. We didn't yet have an embassy. It was called a legation. And I met a very nice gentleman who gave me a written and oral examination in English. And I did very well. And then I didn't hear for a long time. And I frankly had forgotten.
Long time meaning?
Long time meaning several months. And then suddenly I got a letter saying that I have been granted a B'nai B'rith Hillel Foundation scholarship that will give me a second class train ticket from Budapest to Cherbourg, France. It will give me a bunk bed on a converted troop ship, the SS Marine Falcon, from Cherbourg to New York, that I will be met there by a family who will put me up for the night, and then I will get a train ticket from New York to what I now know is Seattle. I pronounced it Seattle at the time. I got a train ticket from New York to Seattle on the Pacemaker and the Empire Builder. I'll never forget it. And when I get to Seattle, I will have to work in a Jewish fraternity house for my room and board, but they will pay for my tuition, and I will get, I forget now, a very modest amount of pocket money. And it sounded like a dream. My girlfriend at the time, who is now my wife, came to the train station with me. We both cried. And then I got on the train. I never forget it. Vienna, which is so splendid and luxurious, was a rotten, poor, decrepit town. I couldn't buy anything. I had no money at the train station, and I got some very sort of lukewarm water out of the tap, which was my drink. I had some bread and salami that I brought with me from Hungary, and that was my food all the way through. As a matter of fact, when my ship arrived in New York, and this is the only moment when I could have turned profoundly anti-American, they took away the remaining half of my salami, because you're not supposed to bring food in the United States. But I went to Cherbourg and got on the boat. I remember a very large black sailor was at the gangplank, and I told him my name, and I was on the list, and he said, "Your bunk is B-20. So I went to B-20, put down my knapsack, that's all I had. And they called for chow, and I didn't know what chow was, but I sort of figured it out. And I was at that stage of my life, this was August of 47, when food to me was still the most important thing in this world, because I had been deprived of so much food. And we had these huge metal trays on the line, and they gave me all I asked for, and I asked for more, and my tray was just filled with everything, potatoes and meat and vegetables and bread and milk and pie. And then at the end of the line, I can see it as clearly as I can see you, there was a huge wicker basket of oranges and a huge wicker basket of bananas. And my mother taught me to always do the right thing, and I didn't know what the right thing was. There was another huge black sailor, and I said, "What's the deal? Can you take an orange or can you take a banana? Can you make your own choice? And he looked at me and he said, man, you eat all the goddamn bananas and all the goddamn oranges you want. And then I knew I was in paradise. And I arrived in New York, and a very nice lady waited for me, and I went home to her house. The next day, they took me to see the rockets at New York City. And then they put me on the train. In Chicago, where I changed trains, I met the head of B'nai B'rith Hillel at the time, who subsequently became president of Brandeis University, Abe Sacker, and his wonderful secretary, Marilyn, who basically picked me on the basis of my papers, so I thank them. But I have to jump ahead because this is interesting. This was in 1947. I was told by Marilyn that in 1980, that's 57, 67, 33 years later, she had a trip to San Francisco, vacation trip. And she got off the plane and took a cab to the city. And there was a gigantic billboard with my picture and the suggestion, vote for Tom Lantos, Democrat Congress. And she thought it was a dream. So she tracked down my campaign headquarters and she said, is this the Tom Lantos who came? So this is how she found out what happened to the boy she picked in 1947 to get a scholarship. He was running for Congress, and that November was elected to Congress.
Let's jump back a little bit. Did you leave any close friends behind in Hungary?
Yes. Yes.
And also, tell us, how did you meet Annette?
I met Annette at a very, very early stage. Our families were friends. I have pictures, as a matter of fact, of the two of us as children in Budapest. We have lots of pictures of the two of us. I don't know how these were saved. Her father, who was born in 1906, and my young uncle, also born in 1906, were schoolmates and friends. And it was through the friendship of Annette's father, who was killed by the Nazis in 44, and my uncle, who perished on the Russian front, that we got together as very small children. It was obvious to both of us we were going to get married.
And who were the friends that you left behind?
They fall into several categories. They were friends of my parents or my aunts and so on. A few distant relatives, one of them still living, the widow of one of my cousins, who is in her late 80s now. These were friends, not friends in the sense that they were the same age, but they were friends of my parents or friends of the family. And my relationship with practically all of these people was to help them during the course of decades. And I must say that my dear friend in Seattle helped me help them in a very big way. He's a man of considerable means, and when I gave $100, he gave $1,000. And I can never be able to express my appreciation for what he had done for large numbers of people he did not know. He met many of them because he came with me to Hungary after a while, but these were just names, and he wrote checks for them. Then there were my classmates. And in an amazing way, and I can't tell you how and why, at our last class reunion in September of 96, there must have been 20 of my classmates still very much alive and active, with a very interesting footnote. When we had a class reunion several years ago, still under the communist regime, many of my classmates were in a retirement status. Now there is a free economy, and practically all of them are working again. So it's a very funny thing. I mean, I can think of at least three of them who were physicians, who when we had the class reunion 5 years ago, were getting their pension and were retired physicians. Every single one of them is now actively practicing his profession as a physician, which is sort of an interesting social commentary on what a free economy does to people. They want to keep working.
Any of these non-Jews?
Yes. At the September meeting, they were there. Most of them were Jewish, but some of them were non-Jewish.
Have you ever discussed with any of these non-Jews what happened?
No. No, I didn't, because I believe, well, in the case of one of them, who was half Jewish, but somehow were not considered Jewish. His family was a very decent family, and they were horrified and appalled by what was happening. And while I don't think they could do much, they were on the right side. I cannot tell you of the non-Jews that I had in school as classmates, where they were on the spectrum in terms of bystanders who turned away, or bystanders who felt for us but didn't do anything or felt they couldn't do anything. I don't think that any of my Christian friends were active perpetrators of any of the horrors that preoccupied Hungary during that period. These were silent spectators, or maybe in a modest way, trying to help.
Did they express ever any sorrow? Or any?
I suspect once or twice in a very perfunctory way, but you see the horror was so overwhelming. These boys, like me, were kids. They were 16, 17-year-old kids. They must have been horrified. I believe most of them had to be horrified. But they clearly had no power. I don't think if any of their parents had any power. It really didn't become a subject of discussion. And I think it would have been very difficult to discuss it, both for them and for us, because we could not blame them, but we clearly could not exonerate them, or their parents, or their grandparents. And while we clearly remembered a great deal, this particular school was a school with a heavy Jewish enrollment, lots of Christian-Jewish friendships and relationships. And I personally feel that on the spectrum, these were probably bystanders, mostly if not all.
Are they still alive, any of them?
Yes, yes.
How do they feel about your position today, your power?
Well, it's a very difficult thing to answer, because on the one hand, in a political sense, there are two Hungarian Americans. Well, this is really not accurate, because one of them was born here. The current governor of New York, Governor Pataki, is of Hungarian background. He has had no relationship with Hungary, and he took his first trip to Hungary, I think, last year, to a village. And I met with him at a Yom HaShoah event in New York, and we had a very nice conversation. And I understand that he's a very decent fellow, and he went to his village, but he really has had no Hungarian, really. He doesn't speak Hungarian. I am the other Hungarian American who politically has a position. And ironically, there are probably two Hungarian Americans who are very well known in Hungary. One, because he has done an enormous amount for Hungary through his foundations, and that's my friend George Soros, who is a multi-billionaire and has done unbelievably impressive things for free and open societies, beginning in Hungary. Just had lunch with him last week, and we're good friends. He has done an incredible amount for Hungary through his philanthropy, which is very intelligent philanthropy. Now he has a university in Budapest, among many other things. And of course he's very controversial, because no good deed goes unpunished, and he has done many good deeds. When I first went back, first of all, I've been going back to Hungary regularly since 1964. So I'm really the only American Hungarian who for the last 32 years, every single year, has been back and heavily involved. First as just a professor and an interested person, but the last 16 years in a political sense. I have tried to do a great deal for strengthening democracy in Hungary. And while this is not the time or the place, because it would take a long time to discuss this, there was a neo-fascist movement in Hungary led by a very talented Hungarian writer, István Csurka, who had a very high position in the leading Hungarian political party several years ago, and I took him on. I had a special session arranged in Congress with a group of my colleagues where we denounced the upsurge of fascism and anti-Semitism. And the Hungarian television carried this with simultaneous translation. And not according to me, but according to many observers in Hungary, I am very happy that I've played a modest role in at least temporarily dealing a setback to neo-fascist anti-Semitic trends in Hungary. I remain very much interested in Hungary. I want Hungary to be a full-fledged member of NATO, a member of the European Union. I want Hungary to be a free and open and democratic society where people of all religions have equal opportunity to achieve anything. So I am very heavily involved with Hungary. I'm very heavily involved with the countries around Hungary. I am perhaps the person in Congress who is most interested in this region and who spends the most time on this region. So I've been to all of these areas many, many times and have done a lot of things. But I'm very conscious of the fact that I'm only one of 435 members, and obviously my power is very limited.
Well, let's go back to how you got to this power. Let's go back to your first arrival to America. You went to Seattle, Washington, and what happened after?
Well, immigrants, I think, fall into two categories. People who never find themselves at home, who always feel that the old country or some idealized version of the old country that never existed is somehow better. Even when they were persecuted, when they were down and so on, everything is better there and somehow they don't fit. And then there are people, and these are the two extremes, and most people fall in between someplace, who love it. I took to the United States like duck takes to water. I loved it. From the day, that's not true. I loved it long before I arrived. And my love affair with America has grown since 1947. Now, every morning we have a small apartment very near the Capitol, and my wife and I and our little dog walk to work. And when I look up the dome and the flag, I choke up every morning. To have a penniless Jewish immigrant from Budapest, the survivor of the Holocaust, be given the privilege of serving in Congress and serving his area and the country is a reward nobody deserves. I've always been public service oriented. When I got my bachelor's and master's degree at the University of Washington, then I went down to Berkeley and got my PhD in economics at Berkeley. Even before I got it, I started teaching. I already taught at the University of Washington. I actually taught a few months after I arrived. I got myself a teaching position at the University of Washington. The only thing I was qualified to teach was Hungarian, and I persuaded the president of the university that the greatness of a university is measured by the variety of languages it teaches, and the only university that was teaching Hungarian at that time was the University of Indiana in Bloomington, and nobody else taught it. And I persuaded the president that it will be a feather in the cap of the University of Washington if they also will teach Hungarian. And he was a very nice fellow. His name was Raymond Allen. And he said, well, we will hire you as our young instructor of Hungarian language and literature. Then my problem came to find students, because who would want in Seattle, which is a Scandinavian area? So we succeeded in recruiting a number of students. And I think I was the youngest faculty member in the history of that university. Started to teach, I believe, in January of 48. And I basically taught from January of 48 until the fall of 80, when I was elected to Congress. I did a few other things in between, but basically I was in university teaching for 32 years. For 10 years, first I established and I directed the study abroad program for the state university and college system in California. And I've been privileged to serve in Congress now for 16 years. I'm about to begin my 17th year.
What was your major motivator to go into politics?
I view politics as public service. I realize that people are cynical about government and politics. I am not. I believe with Winston Churchill that democracy is the worst form of government, except all others that have been tried. And if decent and honest people don't get into public life, somebody else will get into public life. So I am passionately committed to public life. One of my great joys was that our younger daughter's husband, who is a professional architect,
was convinced by me to do this and was elected to the Congress of the United States. And one of my great joys was working with him in the Congress as a colleague. I very much hope at least some of my grandchildren will go into public service. I have 17.
When you first approached public service, how old were you?
Well, that's a difficult one because I first learned about American government, apart from the university courses, from my friend in Alaska, who was and is a very political animal. So I had an excellent sort of private tutor about American government. My wife and I got married in 1950, and I remember that I was very active as a volunteer in a congressional race in 1950 for the Democratic candidate whose name was Harold Taggart and who lost the race, and 30 years later I won that seat. Then in 1952 I organized what we called at that time the Stevenson-Sparkman Democratic Club in my town. I was its first president. I worked with Stevenson. I worked very hard with Stevenson. In 56, I worked very hard with Stevenson on his second campaign. I worked very hard with Senator Alan Cranston in California, with Governor Pat Brown. So I have been involved with politics certainly since the early 50s. Then when our older daughter started elementary school, the path to her school I deemed very unsafe because there were cars going very near it. And I went down to the school board and I proposed that they move this path where these adorable little six-year-old boys and girls were walking about 20 feet inside so they would be far from the cars. And I was treated very badly by the school board, and they told me to get lost. So I ran for the school board, and I won. And I served 8 years on that school board and poured my heart into that. I certainly don't claim credit, but by the time I finished my service as president of that school board, that school district had the highest scores of its children in the whole state of California. We paid the highest salaries to teachers. We had the smallest class size. We had a marvelous program for gifted children. We had a marvelous program for mentally and physically retarded children. And in some ways, those 8 years were unbelievably satisfying. And I really learned firsthand that nobody will come to you and ask you to get into public service. You throw your hat in the ring. And that's what I did. My Hungarian friends, when I was first elected to Congress, asked me, quite a few of them, how did the people in your district, and I have, you know, about 600,000 people in the district, select you with an immigrant, a Jew with an accent? And I said, nobody selected me. I selected myself. I stepped forward. I organized my campaign. I raised the money. I ran my campaign. And I was elected. And that's one of the reasons why I love this country. I mean, nowhere else could this happen.
We're going to stop again for a minute. go back for a minute and would like you to tell us, how did Annette come to the United States, and when did you decide that you're going to get married?
Well, the first part of the question is very easy to answer. She came a year after I did, in 48. When we decided to get married is a subject of great contention between the two of us, because I think it was in the early 30s, and she thinks it was in the mid-30s. But we knew each other in Budapest, and we knew we would get married.
So how it's old were you then?
Well, I was born in 28. So in the mid-30s, I was 7, which, you know, you grow up fast in that old country world.
So the two babies?
And we grew up together, but of course I grew old and she grew young. So now there is a huge time difference between us, a gigantic age gap. But we have been married now almost 47 years. And the first 47 years, quite good. So we're looking forward to the next 47.
How many children do you have?
We have 2 daughters, and we have 17 grandchildren. 17. And the reason is that our 2 daughters decided that since our families were basically killed in the Holocaust, they wanted to create a new family for us, and they have. And it's clearly our greatest joy and the focus of our lives.
Was Annette instrumental in you going into government?
Annette was instrumental in my becoming involved with human rights. She really is the person who did 99% of the work, for instance, on Raoul Wallenberg. The Raoul Wallenberg project began on the kitchen table in our kitchen, and Annette gave years of her life to it. She then suggested, when I was elected to Congress, that I introduce legislation making him an honorary citizen. I got the credit, but she did the work. Later on, she decided that the Holocaust Museum in Washington be placed on Raoul Wallenberg Place. So we went through the process of renaming that street. She did it. Then, not long ago, she succeeded in having a bust of Raoul Wallenberg placed in the Capitol, which was a tremendous achievement. Hundreds of people whose lives Raoul saved flew in from Australia, New Zealand, Europe, Canada, all over the United States, Hungary. Then she worked on a Raoul Wallenberg stamp. Soon in every post office you'll be able to buy a Raoul Wallenberg stamp, which is her doing. She has given much of her life to it, and she has been my inspiration in the work of human rights.
When you first decided to go into politics, was it with the thought of your past, or did the past
Yes.
influence you in any way?
Very much so. Very much so. You don't need to be a rocket scientist to realize how much power there is in the political arena. A Hitler, a Stalin, a Saddam Hussein, a Gaddafi, or conversely, for good, great political leaders can achieve wonderful things, and bad political leaders can create a nightmare. And since money was never very important to me, I felt I wanted to be in public service. So for 33 years I was in university teaching, which is a form of public service.
And for the last 16, I've been in Congress, which is another form of public service. And I wouldn't trade a minute of these 49 years for anything.
What are your proudest achievements in government?
Well, it's not my achievements. In the first place, Annette and I have worked as a team on every project. Secondly, when you are in government in a democratic society, you realize that you don't achieve anything. You can only get any place by motivating your colleagues and lots of other people to work with you. But I would say when my congressional career is over, which I hope is a long ways from now, it will be my work on the field of human rights and a secure Israel, peace in the Middle East, respect for all human beings, irrespective of race and religion and sex and ethnicity. It's not difficult for me to pick the field where I may have made a very modest contribution, and that field is basically human rights.
In the government, how are you accepted as a foreigner, as a Jew? How comfortable are you there?
I'm extremely well accepted and I'm extremely comfortable. As a matter of fact, my background and my experiences and all of my colleagues not only know them but know a great deal about them, as well as the president and the vice president and the previous president and the previous president. My experiences give me a voice of authority on these subjects. You know, American government works in very strange ways. We pride ourselves of being a democratic government, but at the same time we are looking for experts. So if you have in Congress an eminent scientist, his voice is listened to on matters of science. My voice is listened to on matters that relate to my concerns. When I talk about Louis Farrakhan, who spreads venom and anti-Semitism, and I introduce a resolution condemning his speeches, my colleagues listen to me because of who I am. When I deal with a subject like Iran or Iraq or Libya, my colleagues listen to me because they understand my long-term opposition to dictatorial regimes. So I would say that while I certainly didn't ask for this background, my background is an asset, not a liability.
What is your pet project right now? What would you like to accomplish?
I want to see the Middle East peace process continue. I'm spending a lot of my time and energy on it. I believe that the region can be made more stable, less turbulent, less violent, and in whatever way I can. And I spend a lot of time in the Arab countries, in Syria, in Jordan, in Egypt, in Oman. I believe the United States has a tremendously important responsibility in this area, and I try as best I can to bring a voice of reason and compassion and an understanding of all the many complex elements that play in the Middle East. But I am deeply committed to the peace process. I don't think there is any other option in the Middle East.
Who do you think today in the world plays the most important role in humanity and peace? And
well, look, it's always the President of the United States who plays the greatest role. The United States is the one remaining superpower, and our president, whether it's Bill Clinton or George Bush or Ronald Reagan or Jimmy Carter or going back, he is or she is the most powerful force in the world. And I believe this will be the case for a long, long time to come. And I'm very grateful for that, because I view American influence to be an enormously benign influence in the world. It's very fashionable to be critical of the United States, and we obviously have made mistakes. But on a comparative scale, we are by far the greatest force for peace and for decency on this much troubled planet. So I am I'm doing my best to strengthen the influence of the United States, both in the Middle East and globally. That's why I serve on the International Relations Committee. That's my life.
How would you describe yourself as a father?
I'm very committed to my family. I spent an unbelievable amount of time with our two daughters. Still try to. And I'm now spending every spare minute I have with our grandchildren. Annette and I usually have one or two or two or three or four with us. If we don't have any with us, we go visit one family or the other. And our whole life revolves around them. We are enormously fortunate. We lost some grandchildren, but we have 17 living grandchildren, and we feel rich beyond words.
Where do they live?
One family lives in Denver, and one family lives in New Hampshire. And I think I am honest in saying, I think I'm accurate in saying, I have a very personal relationship with every single one of those children. I mean, I'm deeply involved in their lives, in every aspect of their lives. They seem to tolerate me.
When your children, your daughters, were growing up, did they know about you as a Holocaust survivor?
Oh, yes, very much so. Not only did they know about me as a Holocaust survivor, we visited countless Holocaust sites in Europe. My work took me to Europe several months every year for 10 years. They came with us to Israel on countless occasions. And from Yad Vashem to kibbutzim, they have been deeply immersed in our background and in our lives. And one of our daughters attended the Hebrew University in Jerusalem. And both of our daughters are passionately committed to the same political and human rights concerns that Annette and I share.
And your grandchildren?
Very much so, the same way. By now, I think, I want to be accurate, I think almost a half of them have been to visit Holocaust sites. Several of them have been to Israel. As a matter of fact, just this last September, our oldest granddaughter spent some time with us in Israel again. And less than a year ago, our younger daughter and her husband and their baby came to Israel with us. So we make our lives an integral part of their lives, and our lives were defined early on by the Holocaust, and the last 50 years in the value of a free and open society and the prevention of any future nightmares.
I forgot to ask you, was Annette also a Holocaust survivor?
Well, Annette is a Holocaust survivor in a different way. She received protection from the Portuguese minister to Hungary, who received his inspiration from Wallenberg. And she left with the Portuguese minister, Mr. Branquinho, during the most difficult period of 1944 for Switzerland. So in a sense, Raoul Wallenberg saved my life directly, and Raoul Wallenberg saved Annette's life indirectly. I need to tell you that when the Holocaust Museum opened and there was a special children's program, one of our granddaughters, Chelsea, played what to me was an unbelievably moving role in that children's program. She wrote a letter to Raoul Wallenberg thanking him for saving the lives of her grandfather and grandmother so her mother could be born and so that she could be born. And when we placed Raoul Wallenberg statue in the Capitol, there were five speakers. The speaker of our Congress, the speaker of the Israeli Knesset, the speaker of the Hungarian Parliament, the speaker of the Swedish Parliament, and our granddaughter Chelsea. So it was very difficult for us not to cry very hard, because it was an incredibly moving moment. It was on national television, and we all felt that this 12-year-old girl captured the essence of what Raoul Wallenberg was, probably better than the many books that have been written about him.
Well, I'm sure your message to your grandchildren was understood. What would be your message today to future generations?
It's very simple, Renee. We are our brothers and sisters' keepers. Whether these are Buddhists in Burma or Tibet, whether these are Christians who are persecuted, whether these are people who are persecuted because of their pigmentation, the color of their skin, whether they are persecuted because of their ethnic background, like the nightmares we have been through in the former Yugoslavia, we need to speak up and stop these outrages, because the bell always sounds for us. We cannot be bystanders. It's not enough not to be a perpetrator. You must not be a bystander. The prime obligation of every human being is to speak out against injustice committed against any other human being. And the more different that human being is from you, the greater your obligation to speak out for that human being and to defend him. Raoul Wallenberg was not Hungarian, he was not Jewish, he was not persecuted. He was a Christian Swede who was very wealthy and very safe and very secure. And yet he left all of that behind and risked his life and paid with his life for this message that we are our brother's keeper.
Is there anything I didn't ask you that you would like to address?
No, I don't think there is anything you didn't ask me, but I want to say that I can't begin to thank Steven Spielberg and the Shoah Project for doing this. What you are doing personally, what Steven is doing, what all of your associates are doing, is one of the great historic gestures to make this world a more sane place. And as a humble worker in the vineyard of this enterprise, I want to thank you very much for doing it.
We thank you.
It's a pleasure.